Hello all. Today, myself Maheshwari will be taking you through the first unit of Block 4 from the Personality Theories and Assessment, which the topic is Introduction to Assessment and Testing. So far, you all would have, we all have gone through the various theories, approaches that has been put forward by the different psychologists and physiologists and all of those, right? And how so many scientific studies that have happened, which has led to firm up these theories and how they have been proven over a period of time. So this topic will touch upon the introduction to the assessment and testing as to what is needed for us to start on the experimental journey. And then, later the other units will cover the various tests and all that has been used over a period of time and has kind of got standardized. So all that we'll see later, but in this, today we are going to cover the introduction to assessment and testing. So in my next slide, I'm going to cover the basic definitions that we have read so far and will be commonly used. So I just wanted to kind of create one slider on this for you guys to just have a look. As you would have read many personality definitions and various different theorists have put forward their, how they would want to define a personality. So in this particular section, in this unit, the personality has been defined as the sum total of all the traits of an individual who interacts with the environment, and it includes all the traits of the personality. And what is assessment? Assessment is the measurement of individual differences having to do with various personality traits. And to do with specific with the personality assessment, there has been a lot of systematic efforts that have gone into to understand and predict behavior of an individual. So you know that each individual is different. No two individuals are same. Even our fingerprints are different and unique to each individual. So it is important that some kind of studies are involved to understand the behavior of each individual or at a very high level and be able to predict the behavior of an individual. So that is where all the studies have happened around this particular construct, right? So what are the traits? Traits which forms the part of the behavior or of the overall individual are the observed consistent behavior of a person. It reflects the characteristics by what and how the person does and how well the task is done. These are permanent, consistent, pervasive, and they depend on the goals, values, and beliefs. So this I just wanted to cover so that we get a fair idea. Now, this chapter mainly covers the history of how the entire personality assessment has evolved over a period of time, right? So as I said, the entire study of personality is based on the pervasive theme that there are individual differences in people's behavior and experience. So personologists have to deal with two related concerns. Now, who are personologists? Personologists are those people who study the behavior or the personality of an individual from a holistic standpoint. So these people have just two concerns, that as to how people are different from one another and in which ways they are different from one another. So there are various use of different concepts to describe the distinctiveness about an individual. What are the terms that can be used to depict the various aspects of the human behavior? And the second one being how to measure these individual differences. And this is what is the process, overall process is called assessment. Now, the purpose of measurement of personality is to describe a person in terms of some of the measurable factors, such as the traits. Now, what is a formal personality assessment? It is a tool that will not only obtain information about individual differences in a meaningful and an exact manner, but also it will be possible to communicate this information to others in a clear and an unambiguous fashion. So does anyone want to attempt as to various personality assessment tools that we have come across or read so far?
We have cattle's 16 PF and Bell's adjustment.
Yes, right. Then we also use like case studies or interviews, right? These are other methods and various tests that are being used. You're right. So these are the various ways which have been, you know, devised by the various theorists. And they have been, in the way they have been standardized, one is able to also get information in the exact manner as to what they want to depict. So, you know, 16PF will tell you the traits in the way they have categorized into those, you know, five dimensions and the 16 traits that we speak about. And then we are also able to communicate that information back to the individual who would have taken that self-report in a very clear fashion as to this is what your report means and this is what it will be. So to the specific of that, similarly, like an MBTI, you know, which Myers-Briggs, forgot the full name, Myers-Briggs.
Type indicator.
The indicator. That has been... that's very commonly used in the organization setup. So that also helps in the initial screening of what the personality is of a person and then see how they can, you know, take up the person in the overall growth and stuff like that in an organization, right? So these are the various assessment tools. We are not going to learn assessment tools per se in this chapter, but we are going to see how they are being standardized. And it's the first step as to how they go about, right? Now let's come to the history of personality assessment. So I have about 6 slides to 7 slides on this because it's a big huge details that have been given because they have shown how the personality assessments or how the experimental studies have evolved over a period of time, what has gone into and how far we have reached. So I have tried to kind of collate this information in a tabulated form so that it's easy for us to go through. Now, the history of psychological testing is detailed as below, and it goes as early as 1000 BC when, you know, Chinese people introduced the written test to fill up the civil service positions. In United States also, in around 1850, tests were developed for civil service examinations. Then there was one person called James McLean Cattle who developed a mental test in 1890 to assess the college students so that they can measure their strength, resistance, pain, and reaction time. Similarly, Alfred Binet and Theodore Simon, who were the first developed this first scale to classify the mentally retarded children, which we now call as, you know, specially abled people. So a Binet-Simon scale of mental development was developed in around 1905, where the, you know, the officials of France had asked them to see how they would wanted to distinguish people who are, you know, kids who are able to, you know, absorb faster, the ones who are not. So they wanted to, you know, work especially with these kids who were not able to absorb fast and design something different for them. So that's how it started off. The origin started off like that. Then in 1914, there has been development of Army Alpha and Beta test for World War I for hiring new recruits to Army. Then Terman in 1916 developed a Stanford Binet test, which was an, you know, extension to what Binet and all had introduced. And he introduced the term called intelligent question, which we say IQ. So this is how the chronological order has been. So I have tried to put as much as I could in this. Between 1920 and 1940, projective test and personality test using factor analysis were devised. So it goes back to the statistical, you know, tools that were being used, goes back to as back as 1920s. Between 1941 to 1960, many vocational interest tests were developed. And between 1961 to 1980, neuropsychological testing became quite prominent. And from 1980 to till present date, as we have seen, many tests have been developed that could be administered through the computer, scored through computer, interpreted through computer. So it makes the whole, the assessment much faster and much more standardized and for that matter, and it can be, you know, used over a larger population. So as we go back to the history, Hippocrates, a Greek physician, was one of the first one, as we go back to 470 BC, he theorized that, he defined personality from the bodily aspects. So he theorized that body has four fluids that we have read even earlier, which are called humors, and he divided into blood, phlegm, yellow bile, and black bile. And he said that these fluids affect the human body in many ways and helps to distinguish the person basis this. Then Galen, another Greek physician, picked up from there, and he, based on the body fluids in 190 AD, he divided these into further four temperaments, which were based on these body fluids, which is sanguine, phlegm, choleric, and melancholic. So he defined, you know, the various characteristics one can see if if the temperament is sanguine, the person will be warm, optimistic, confident, so and so forth, which you have read. And he was of the opinion that the healthy body directly reflects the balance and the ratio of these four body temperaments that he had defined. Avicenna, a Muslim physician, he introduced these four body temperaments to the Arab world, and he did a lot of analysis of, you know, human illnesses, and his contribution was huge in the Arab world. The other person, which is a well-known person, is Wilhelm Wundt. As you would know, he's a German philosopher and known as the father of experimental psychology. So he was the first person who founded the first psychology laboratory in Leipzig, Germany. And it's a very, very important one, which gets often asked. He made a clear distinct between human body and personality. So all this while, we would have seen that, you know, people, theorists were distinguishing individual behavior based on the body structures and body fluids and stuff like that. So he was the one, he made a clear distinct, saying that a personality and a mental aspect is also involved in identifying the personality of an individual. So based on the same thing, four temperaments, sanguine, phlegm, cholera, melancholy, four dimensions of human personality were identified, and he gave a psychological touch to the personality test. Am I going too fast or it's okay?
No, this is fine.
Okay. Contributors of the 20th century. So these may be a little unknown names because we haven't, these are not getting covered in most of our books. But they have also contributed in bringing out different aspects of the personality. So in 1905, Eduard Spranger, a German philosopher, theorized four attitudes towards ethical values. And he named those value attitudes as artistic, religious, theoretic, and economic. Hugo Mansberg, a professor at Harvard University, created a survey where he asked executives of different organizations to list the qualities they would expect to see in their employees. Based on that list, he devised the first personality test for employers to make the best hiring decision. So that was the start from there. Ernest Kretschmer, a German philosopher, presented a theory of four character styles: hypomanic, depressive, hyperesthetic, or anesthetic. There was another person called Erich Fromm, a German philosopher. He termed four human orientation as exploitative, hoarding, receptive, and marketing. So these are the various aspects that have been brought about by the various theorists and physiologists, for that matter. Earlier, you know, the term philosophy or a philosopher was more prominent before the time of, before Carl Jung came into existence. So when Carl Jung, a Swiss psychologist, started, theorizing, from there the word psychology took more prominence, and he was the person who theorized that people always prefer certain identifiable behaviors if they are given a free choice. And based on these human preferences, he identified different personality types. So the amount of work that he put in creating these theories, Myers-Briggs and Catherine Briggs, they picked up from there and they applied the Jung's theory to develop types of personality, which is called MBTI, the Myers-Briggs type indicator. And basis the responses to below questions that they said, you know, whether the person prefers the source of energy to be internal or external, whether their perception or their perceiving through senses or are intuitive, the decision making is logical or based on feelings, or you know, if the lifestyle is organized or adaptable. So basis the responses that one would get, he identified four cognitive functions, which is sensory perception, sensory judgment, intuitive feeling, and intuitive thinking. So these itself go up to, you know, a combination of 16 basis which they are able to clearly identify the personality of an individual. And based on and being influenced by Myers-Briggs, David Kersey, an American psychologist, brought about a personality assessment scale called Temperament Sorter, which identified four personality temperaments. So he named these temperaments like as guardian, rational, idealist, and artisan. Now, guardian is one, that person will value responsibility, team membership, and his core desires are security, service, and system. And he is responsible towards his job, his organization, family, society. So that temperament was identified as guardian. And rational is a person who will value knowledge, skills, intuitive evaluation, analytical, experimental, and factual. That person is primarily a knowledge seeker. Idealist is a person who will follow with their intuitive feeling preferences and perform great tasks, develop themselves and as well as the people around them. And artisan is a person who's an action seeker. And the core needs is to, for action and variety. And this person will be using their five senses to understand information, would be impulsive, spontaneous, dislike routine, schedules, but love the freedom of action and experiments. So these various aspects that you see also help us to look at how in different ways an individual can be observed. And, basis these, we can also, when we are, trying to predict the behavior of the person, these various theories can be put into place and used. Moving on to the next one. So personality assessment also gained importance in the workplaces and started off with the 1920s when German government established a program for selecting officer candidates. Then Germans in 1936 also invented a modern assessment center with setting up 15 psychological laboratories with 84 psychologists evaluating over 40,000 candidates per year. And this method would examine the overall personality of and produce an overall evaluation of suitability. So it was so well accepted that even later the British government modeled the War Office Selection Boards were modeled on this German assessment center method. And, instead of selecting candidates for their army officials through interviews and focusing on a candidate's social class, which was, kind of got exhausted because the requirement for World War was very high, they started using these German-based assessment center models to identify the leaders in combat. So extending to that further, The Office of Strategic Services, which was created in 1942 by the US government to prepare for World War II, William Donovan, who was the World War I hero and Wall Street banker, was the OSS director. He, along with Murray, set up the German Assessment Center to screen applicants, and there are evidences that it was quite an effective process for that matter. And you would have seen there are many movies based on these recruits that have been done and all of that. Yeah. So there are three points about this assessment tradition. Is that this candidate evaluation was based on the competence, and there was no weightage given to any psychopathological disorder that the person may or may not have, purely on competence. They were consistently evaluated. This process was, the validity of this process was consistently evaluated. And Eysenck demonstrated in 1953 that the 1 hour of paper pencil testing yielded same results as against the 2.5 day assessment center. And this holds true even today. So these are the traditions which are kind of being followed even today in many forms. So as you can see that, you know, the personality assessment scales have been devised to measure several personality concepts, and Murray, Barrick and Michael Count showed that personality measures based on five-factor model, the OCEAN model that we have read, predicts the occupational performance across a wide range of jobs and industries. So it's not just limited to the army, you know, though it started off from the government and the army officials and all. It also got extended to the other jobs and industries for that matter. So this was the history that we covered of how so far we have evolved in terms of the various assessments, or how the, you know, the approaches have developed regarding the personality assessment over a period of time. Now, there are two important steps in personality assessment which can help making decisions about people in organization. One is, you know, it should specify the agenda for personality assessment, which is to forecast individual differences in a person's potential for the person to be able to, you know, get along with the team and the overall organization, and also moving ahead in the career, right? The second step will be to decide which aspect of personality one wants to measure. So it could be both also. But if one wants to assess the personality from an inner identity perspective, then the measure of values is needed. And this would help evaluate the person, how culturally fit he would be to that organization, as against the predicting, trying to predict the overall performance at work. But if one wants to assess personality from an outside reputation perspective, so many of you who are still, I know, who work with an organization would have seen a 360 degree feedback instrument, which is used in many organizations to take an overall perspective of the individual, not just the self, the immediate managers, but also from an, you know, from the various stakeholders that they deal with, even their views are taken to assess the personality and how well they are being rated, so that they can improve and improvise further on that. So the optimal use of assessment of reputation is to forecast occupational performance as against the person culture fit. So one needs to identify what really needs to be measured and what is important from that perspective. You can do both, but it has to be done too separately and not kind of, you know, mixed together. Otherwise it gets a little bit messy. So these are the important steps in the personality assessment from a work standard point of view for the various organizations that people can adopt to. Now, there are various other fields which are associated with personality assessment. So over and above the various tools that we have seen, even these are the ones which are used. Astrology, it's commonly used to determine the personality of the individual, and primarily to predict the future basis the date of birth, place and time, you know, from the planetary position. So we all know this, astrology. Biorhythms is a method which was initially developed by Wilhelm Fliess, a colleague of Sigmund Freud and was promoted by George Thoman in 1973. As per this theory, the day-to-day effectiveness is governed by a position on three cycles, physical, emotional, and mental, and which are fixed at the time of the birth, or it starts from the time of the birth. And, you know, these biorhythms are like your sleep rhythms or, you know, some schedule that, that you set up, and from your biological standpoint, it helps you to move around that. So this also kind of, you know, can help to predict the behavior of an individual from that perspective. Palmistry is another, which we all know, looking at the hand lines, one can predict the characters of an individual. And this has been in use as early as 3000 BC in China. Humoral theory and somatotype theory we have read. Somatotype is about the body bills, and humoral theory is about the four humors that we just read about, right? So these are the various other fields which are associated with personality assessment and can go along with the other tests that we can administer. Now, talking about the influence of psychological assessment. So scientific personality assessment has its roots in the study of individual differences through psychological measurement, right? So Darwin's work on evolution has had considerable impetus to the study of individual differences. And Sir Francis Galton, who was inspired by Darwin's work, and I think he's also related to him, he did the further study of the inheritance of these differences. He's another British scholar of 19th century. James M. Cattell, which we spoke about in the history also, he's the pioneer in the study of individual differences in the US. He developed a mental test to assess the college students to measure their strength, resistance to pain, and reaction time. Alfred Binet, we already, you know, spoke about that. He also was the person who got inspired by Galton's work on individual differences. And he did a series of studies which involved tasks like observation on body types, head measurement, handwriting, word knowledge, reasoning, numerical ability, various tasks he kind of considered, which led to the development of the famous Binet test of intelligence, though it started from the, you know, the history that we spoke about of the mentally retarded kids, but he kind of extended it further. There were some tasks in the test which involved even telling stories about pictures, identifying ink blots, which also paved way for the evolving projective test of personality that we have read. Yeah. Now, Galton introduced the use of direct behavior samples in real life situation, which was extended to US and France, and his followers, Carl Pearson and Charles Spearman, who are quite well known in the statistical world, who provided the powerful tools for work in the assessment. So this overall covers the, you know, the history and the evolution of the psychological assessment. Now, just to take you back as to what is the purpose of personality assessment. We know what personality means. We know what assessment means. Now, what is the purpose of it? The purpose is aimed at, as defined by Nanadi, is at studying the four broad types of traits, which are social traits, motives, personal conceptions, and adjustments. Traits are, you know, how a person interacts with the other persons in society, related to temperament and character. It could be like friendliness, honesty, shyness, etc., right? Motives are all your non-biological drives, which constitute the personality dynamics, like your need to earn money. You know, it could be driven by the need to earn money or prestige, need for the academics achievement, or need for affiliation or aggression, anything. So these are the motives, you know, that can define a personality. And it's a sum total of all of this. Personal conceptions are like person's attitude towards self and others, values, interests, beliefs, and etc. Human adjustment refers to the establishment of a satisfactory relationship which represents harmony, conformance, adaptation, and etc. And it is finding and adopting behaviors to the changing environment, and the balance needs to be created to feel in a more harmonious state or more satisfied with all the needs, right? So that's the adjustment, which is also a key to the personality construct, right? So the traits would be like freedom, instability, all of these would be part of human adjustment. So the purpose, overall purpose, is to study these broad types of traits which constitute the overall personality, right? Now, what it also says is that all these different types of traits that we just spoke about, they are correlated with each other. They are not independent. They are dependent on each other. So to give an example, so if the social trait is of dominance, it is going to be influenced, or it is going to influence the motives, the needs, or the values, or the attitudes and adjustment of a person. To take another example, if somebody is highly prejudiced against a particular caste, which is his personal attitude, right? Then the individual's social interaction, his motives and adjustment also kind of gets affected by it, because the way he would react and act towards that particular caste because he has some prejudice against that would all affect his overall behavior towards that particular thing. So that is how they are all interlinked, and they do not work in as a independent characteristic. And it also says that if a person has a satisfactory general adjustment, then the person's social traits, motive, and personal conceptions would be in congruence with social norms, right? And while on the other hand, if an individual is maladjusted, they would have extreme social traits, eccentric motives, and personal conceptions. So it automatically, so once you are adjusting to a particular societal norms, you are more incongruent to that. And if you are not, you are more, revolting, or all your traits kind of change towards that particular situation, it would show a different characteristic. So that's what they are trying to say by saying how these traits are interlinked. Now, coming to the main topic of the overall chapter is the testing and the measurement concepts. Now, as you know, assessment techniques must meet four technical criteria before they can be considered scientifically acceptable measures of individual differences in people's enduring qualities. Now, these criteria are standardization, norms, reliability, and validity. So when, any research methodology that is being used, these are the four criteria are very, very key to do any kind of test and measurement of that aspect. Okay, moving on to this, what is standardization and what is norms? In the interest of time, I'll just take example rather than reading it out fully. Standardization, as we had gone in our last year's, in our first year's practicals, we had gone through the Bell adjustment inventory, the 16 PF also you can look at, the GMA that you can look at, the general mental ability test that was done in our projects. You see that there was, in that self-report, it was clearly written that the examiner should read out the subject very clearly, the printed instructions, how the question needs to be answered, what is the time frame. So all this was clearly detailed out. And then, for the various other tests that we had done, there was a detailed information like a manual or a one pager also that was good enough. It clearly showed as to whose this assessment should be taken, who should not be given, who should be, which kind of sample group that needs to be selected, what would be the scoring pattern, how it needs to be interpreted. So all this comes under standardization, and it is very, very important for measurement of personality dimensions or any kind of research for that matter. It's important that operational definitions are clearly carved out and it's standardized, so that when there any kind of test is being repeated, the interpretations are more or less the same, which helps us to kind of get the correlations and other measurements that we need to do. It becomes easier to be executed by any set of people, right? So that is what is key in a standardization. Norms, as you would have seen, that it clearly identifies against a raw score, whether it's a low, high, or an average, depending on that particular aspect that is being tested. So for a general ability test compared to Bell's adjustment inventory, the norms vary, right? As to what, so that needs to be clearly again being called out. So that helps to compare the individual scores to a overall group, or how the person ranks, and which can also be converted into a percentile scores. It is not applicable to all, but that is how one can do it to define these norms which are applicable for that particular test that needs to be conducted. So that's about standardization and norms. And the other two criteria which are key to the assessment is reliability and validity. So these are the two last aspects that we will study, and these are very, very key. We have read this in the research methods as well as in statistics. Now, what is reliability? Reliability is any test, whether personality or intelligence or aptitude, should demonstrate reliability, which means that repeated administration of the same test or another form of test should give the same results or scores. So it should be consistently show or demonstrate that this particular test is reliable and can be consistently used. That helps to measure that aspect much more in a clear manner. Now, there are various types of reliability. So we are not going to go much into detail of which is internal and external, though it gets divided into that. There are four that is covered in this chapter. So the two is from an external reliability perspective, test-retest reliability and interscorer reliability. Now, test-retest, as the word itself, says that it refers to the consistency or stability of an assessment technique which is given to the same group at different occasions, at two different occasions. So let's say a test has been given to a set of people on, on a Monday, and the same test will get administered on the next Monday or any time duration that can be set. And when it is correlated, the scores, when are they being correlated, they should be showing a consistent result, even though it has been done after a period of time. Yes, there are some flaws to this particular testing, but it shows that this particular technique or a tool is much more reliable. And the acceptable levels of reliability coefficient is to most of the psychological tests is above 0.70. And the more it approaches to +1 is the more reliable the test is when it is being retested, which means that the scores should match their first scores quite closely. Right? The other one is interscorer reliability, which means that the degree of agreement between two or more judges in scoring the same assessment test, there should be an agreement between two or more judges in scoring the same assessment test. It must demonstrate whenever scoring involves subjective interpretations, such as those made by personologists examining projective data. Now, to give a very basic example, you know, in a football match or any match when there are two referees who, you know, are being called upon to see whether, you know, whether there was a flaw when the game was being played. So their two opinions are being taken. So that interscoral reliability is being arrived at, whether they both are saying the same thing or not, and they both are in agreement with the outcome of it. If not, then the interscoral reliability is not to be trusted. So similarly, what it says is, when the norms are being standardized, when the key norms are being standardized, even if there are two different examiners, they are able to use those norms to get to the similar results. And if they are not getting to the same result, that means there's something wrong to the norms that are being defined and they are not being clearly understood. So that is what interscorer reliability means. Moving on to the next two types of reliability is parallel forms reliability and split half reliability. Now, parallel forms reliability is another external type of reliability, which is based on correlation of two versions of the same test, which is made up of similar items administered to same group of individuals. So for example, there is a two different versions of a test that has been designed, which is on a similar items. So one set A, and they are being divided randomly into set A and a set B. Let's say a set A is given to a group A and a set B is given to a group B. The results should be, the test should yield the parallel, the reliability of these parallel forms should be the similar results that should be scored. So that is what is parallel forms of reliability. Now, split half reliability is a little different, wherein the same test is split into two sets. It could be, basis the odd numbered items versus the even numbered items, or the, first 50 questions and the second 50 questions are divided, are given. And then the correlation will be basis the two sets of sum scores with each other. And that is what it says. The correlation between these sets is termed split half reliability, and it reflects the internal consistency of that particular test. And it also says that people who will score high, let's say if we selected odd items versus even items, they should also score high on the even items, while the vice versa should be the same. And if it is not, then there is the reliability issue in the overall personality assessment technique that is being devised. So these are the various types of reliability that we have also read in the past. This is like a brush up, and I hope I'm giving the right examples. Coming to validity. Validity is what test measures, what it is intended to measure, and predicts what it is supposed to predict. So even though a test that is being devised is reliable, but if it is not valid enough, then the whole technique goes for a toss. It cannot be really be useful. So this is another significant concept in the personality assessment. There are three main types of validity. One is content validity, criterion related validity, and construct validity. Now, content validity is is a tool which will include items whose contents are representative of the entire domain or dimension it is supposed to measure. So let's say I'm trying to measure shyness, and I am looking at the different aspects of shyness. While I'm looking at that, and I'm trying to assess the construct of shyness in this overall test measurement, if it so happens that the content which is being looked at is not is not validating the about shyness and it is something else, then the whole content validity goes for a toss, right? So what it says is content validity is almost entirely determined by agreement among experts that each item does in fact represents the various aspects of the variable or attribute being measured. So if the test construct is based on shyness, and while I am checking on the construct of anger, then these two, the basic content is not in line with what we are checking. So it can go a little haywire, right? So that content needs to measure what it's supposed to measure. So that is the first one. Second one is criterion related validity. For criterion related validity, personality assessment is commonly undertaken for the purpose of making predictions about specific aspects of an individual behavior. So the way you would have performed in your academics, in your school or in management school or in your workplace, that can be predicted. So if you have done well in, let's say, in your academics, it is usually predicted that you may be successful in your occupation. So that kind of, at a very high level, it's not usually true. But that could be the way the criterion can be validated. So what they're trying to say here is, let's say, in my management school, if my GPA score was something X, and if I've taken another common aptitude test, it should also be able to predict the GPA which is closer to that. So if that kind of validity is, able to do it, that means that this test that is being trying to be, is being devised is more or less kind of correlated, and it will be valuable for us to take it forward. Now, there are two types of criterion related validity, predictive validity and concurrent validity. Predictive validity involves determining the capacity of a test to predict some criterion behavior in the future. An intelligent test has predictive validity if it accurately predicts the subsequent performance in school or, even for the freshers in an organization setup. Now, concurrent validity involves the extent to which a test correlates significantly with another currently derived test from a theory or existing criterion measure. So let's say if a person is going through anxiety symptoms and when he speaks during, when he speaks to a counselor, the interview results of showing his level of anxiety, and if he's being administered a test, that anxiety level, if it doesn't correlate, that means there is some flaw with the concurrent validity of that particular test that is being designed, that was administered. So that is how the concurrent validity can be looked at. It also states that the clinicians must not have prior knowledge of the patient's paranoid or any other, negative aspects, so that it cannot be biased, which could lead to criterion contamination for that matter. So these are the various limitations when we are doing the validity test as well. Moving on to the last part of it, which is the construct validity, where the concept of construct validity addresses the question of how well a test measures something that is but a useful abstraction invention. So the constructs like self-actualization, ego, anger, self-esteem, intelligence, all these are the various constructs, right? And that needs to be validated that this is what we are measuring and not something else. Now, when you look at it, there are two types of construct validity. One is convergent and the other one is divergent. Convergent is where the test measures a construct where we can correlate the test scores of the construct in question with scores from another test, which is measuring the same construct. For example, you are measuring the construct of self-esteem. And if a new test also measures the construct of self-esteem, then it is positively correlating and it becomes a convergent validity that you're doing, right? Whereas in divergent validity, we need to check or look at the aspects that does not correlate with the measures of qualities that it was not intended to measure. For the same example, if I take in the self-esteem test, so if the self-esteem test was not supposed to measure, let's say the intelligent aspect, and if when we are validating it, and if we find that it is not checking the intelligent aspect in this self-esteem test, then it is, you know, it says that its divergent validity is also being verified. It is also called as discriminant validity. It's the same thing. And it's again an important step in establishing the construct validity of an assessment technique. So these validity, the various validity types also needs to be confirmed before, you know, finalizing any technique using it across the subjects that you would want to use it. So these needs to be validated and found reliable, then only the entire scientific testing that one would do will be more congruent and more, you know, if these are not being like looked at initially, then later on after all the, you know, things that we would do and we find that these are not congruent, then it can lead to, you know, major flaws in your entire scientific study. So these are the some key aspects that we had to cover from this topic standpoint. So that's about it from my end. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much. Kritika, can we stop the recording?